Mike Kleen, Gotta Come Home Sometime, Part 1 of 4. July and August in New Britain regularly duke it out to determine which month will earn the title of summer's most miserable. Historically, July gets the temperature nod, but August's higher relative humidity keeps her in the ring as an even odds contender. Most miserable had more meaning in 1970 than it does today, especially to an active 13-year-old living in a house whose only AC unit sat in the window of his parents' master bedroom. 13 is a difficult age, and the summer of 1970 was a difficult time. I'd left my younger brothers, Justin and Joe, behind when I'd graduated from Smalley Elementary, June of 1969, and I was actually looking forward to my second and final year at Hale Junior High before moving on to the big time at New Britain High, my first school farther than 3 blocks from home. Smalley Elementary sat a mere 2 blocks east of her house on Putnam Street, while Hale was located a block west, followed by a jag south. Shucks, even CCD at St. Mary was just a half mile away. 8th grade at Hale had introduced me to Mr. Harrison and the importance of current events. I'd join in with the grumblings of my classmates concerning the waste of time current events were, but secretly I enjoyed learning about the world. The late 60s provided plenty of race riots in the U.S., and just when I thought that we'd turn the corner and the riots had ended, July 4th brings riots down at Asbury Park, and less than 4 weeks later, we have 6 days of rioting in neighboring Hartford. Meanwhile, in Ireland, the IRA was fighting dirty against the stinking Brits who refused to give Ireland home rule, the USSR is conducting atomic bomb tests, and it seems like jumbo jets are falling out of the sky and crashing every week. My newfound proclivity to keep up with current events demonstrated time and again that the world's going nuts, what with Libya confiscating the property of Jews, the ANC in South Africa setting off pamphlet bombs that scare everybody right before Jim Foshi's government declared that Chinese people qualified as white, not colored, and a bomb going off at the University of Wisconsin in Madison that kills a student. Madison, a city my dad had brought the whole family to just the summer before. Of course, as they say, it can always get worse, and it does. When a police officer in the city of brotherly love is killed in a riot with the Black Panthers. Even my favorite current events TV show is ruined when Chet Huntley retires from NBC's The Huntley Brinkley Report, which ends the "Good night, David, good night, Chet, and good night for NBC News" catchphrase that had started the year I'd been born. Naturally, not all the news was bad. On July 18th, Willie Mays got his 3,000th hit. Giants won 10-1. And July had Pete Rose and Jim Fossey stepping all over each other, while Tom Seaver, Catfish Hunter, Sandy Koufax, the Yankees, Mets, Red Sox, and Phillies were the kind of current events I could share with my buddies without fear of ridicule. Months later, I rooted for Baltimore in the World Series. The Orioles were half the distance from New Britain than the Reds were, and Mom really disliked Pete Rose anyway. Not only did Baltimore win, but 1970 also brought us our first African-American World Series umpire with Emmett Ashford officiating. The summer of 70 was steamy, the world was hot, and so was I. A bad combination for anyone, let alone a 13-year-old boy burdened with 2 younger brothers. And that mix of heat and humidity led to me making a really bad choice followed by a terrible one. Good old Freddie Nietzsche may have been correct when he said, "That which does not kill us makes us stronger." But he left out the part about things that don't quite kill you, leaving you scarred for life.